This is our 289th meeting since we started in January of 2009. We put a speaker on every, different speaker on every week, a different subject. We require our speaker to take a position on an issue, express a point of view. They have to be for or against something. We don't care what it is. We give them an hour to make a presentation. We go over an hour, we cut them off. If anybody interrupts the speaker, remind the interrupter, we only listen one fool at a time. That's one of our rules. Then we have questions and answers, not speeches, from the audience. And then we have remarks, rebuttals, everybody in the audience that wants to gets 5 minutes at this podium to respond to the speaker said, for or against. And our speaker gets the last word, gets comment, to close the meeting. But before we put on our speaker, are there any announcements? Now's the time for announcements. Anybody has announcements? Any announcements? No announcements? I can't believe this. Nobody has announcements. Jim, you got an announcement? No? You got any announcements? No? You got any? Well, whatever they want to say, you know, get out of their system.
I was in the Plano Balloon Festival last night.
Okay, cut the microphone.
My microphone.
Oh, I can speak.
I was at the Plano Balloon. I was at the Plano Balloon Festival last night, and that was great. If you ever want to go up there, a lot of traveling up north, but 20 balloons they weren't able to. 20 balloons, but they weren't able to put them up because it was too windy. But it was a beautiful night and a lot of kids there, and today it's going to be people to people. You can't move through because there's so many people. Beautiful weather, but last night it was drizzling a little bit, but a lot of fun. I was on the M&F committee. We're not supposed to say that over our phones, but M was for money and F was for finance. So when I was coming back in, I said I had perishables. So in case any agents were listening in, they wouldn't know that I had the money. And I had a bag man with me too. It was real cute. And I had an undercover cop there, and the guy was crazy. He was putting his skull in his mouth. I said, ugh. And he was a SWAT team guy. And but he was wearing earrings. I said, what is this? Always undercover. Well, that's all that I have right now.
Any other announcements?
Oh, there's a movie.
Right over here. So we got to do this again. That way you don't want to make announcements later.
Well, there's a movie at the Texas Theater tomorrow at 4 about the Iowa Sinapa scenario where all those students were killed. And I guess it's $10. That's usually what the movies cost down there. And so I don't remember the name of it right off, but that's what it's about. So if anybody's interested in that.
Any other announcements? Okay, well, I guess that's it. Next week we have Wasting Away in West Texas. Marvin Mavis Belize will be our speaker. It's on the itinerary in front of you there. October 3rd we have Stealing Votes in Texas, Saving Our Votes. Dr. Laura Presley, who, to 2014 candidate for Austin City Council, she'll be here speaking. That's also on the itinerary. There's also on the itinerary, I got Christmas Whimsy at December 12th. It's a little ahead of time, but it's there. You can look it up. Anyway, our speaker tonight is John Lipinski. He spoke here before a few years ago. It's been a while.
Four or five talks.
So he looks pretty much the same. I was surprised. Anyway, I was expecting maybe he'd look a little different, you know, 3 years, whatever. But he looks pretty much the same. He's going to discuss what you need to know about labyrinths, winding pathways set up indoors and out to be walked as a foundation for meditation. There's a single path with no dead ends or interesting paths leading to the center. Content could be for inspirational, motivational, or spiritual purposes. John will discuss labyrinth as a means of one's personal journey toward inner wisdom. He will give us details on how he uses it for meditation and question inquiry. Learn the details to see if knowledge of the technique will be useful to you. So without further ado, please give a very, very warm welcome to John Lipinski.
Yeah, that has a change. I got to hold it.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I'm kind of a change agent. It's kind of interesting. What happened here? Yeah. If you ever go to church, you know, some people always sit in the same pew.
And so I give a lot of talks over the years. I've done a lot of meditation for 20, 25 years. And so I changed to pew alignment up here tonight.
Is this Roy?
Yes.
No.
Okay.
No. Calvin.
Calvin, come on in, man. That's right, yeah. Show him the way. So I changed it up the layout of the area tonight because I know about the 45-degree angle, and I know I need to have room, and I don't like people walking over me, so that's why I changed it up, and it was interesting to hear all the people making their comments about it. I'm not really a minister, but I have a couple ministries, and one of them is my email list. And I have my email list that I have here, and I have 11 email lists, and since 1998, I've probably sent over 60,000 emails out because I'm a voracious reader, and I like to share a lot of information. So tonight I'm going down the black hole a little bit. We'll talk about the labyrinths, and I'll show you some, and I'll show you what's good and bad of them and what we're doing with them. So this is my Travel and Salvation show here. And it's about labyrinths, and labyrinths is not a maze, and we'll talk about that in a couple minutes. Anything I say up here is whatever you feel is correct for you. If it doesn't resonate with you, there's no hard feelings. I'm sharing with you my ideas. Now, there's a guy here, there's a guy named Graham Hancock, and I want to talk about him for a couple seconds to really get an idea what labyrinths are all about. He has about six books on Amazon, if you're interested. This is one he's familiar with, Fingerprints of the Gods. His wife is an international photographer. And so even though our government and all the people around the world say there's no underground cities, that's totally false and incorrect. So they would look at a picture like this and say, well, this is just a natural formation. And we can all look at it and say, that's an underground city. There's one off the coast of Cuba on the west coast, and they've looked at it with our submarines. And they've sensed the power source down below there. So there's these places all the time. When India had their tsunami, they had a bunch of scientists, and they could see 100 feet down that there was a city. But they couldn't acknowledge that because they weren't supposed to be. But there it was, and so we have a problem. This is our old friend, the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant, he feels, is in Ethiopia. And this Ark of the Covenant was used in the King's Chamber of the Great Pyramid as a generating machine. And they used to do their water and all kinds of energy all through Egypt. And he saw a couple of the priests in Ethiopia that basically had this thing, and they die in 3, 4, 5 months because the radiation from the Ark of the Covenant would mess their eyes up. Wow. And then this is what I want to show you. I want to talk a little bit about the war on consciousness before we get into labyrinths, because in my opinion, labyrinths will help us contain and keep our consciousness and our imagination very functional. But a lot of people don't want us to because the government doesn't want us to think and imagine. And when I do my guided imageries, the fastest thing on the planet is not the speed of light. In my opinion, it's the speed of thought. That is a thought. And that was pretty fast, too. So I have a couple of little quick things here. Scientists really don't understand consciousness, so let's see what that is. And if you can't. Can everybody hear that?
And you know, that leads me to ask, what is death? Our materialist science reduces everything to matter. Materialist science in the West says that we are just meat, we're just our bodies. So when the brain is dead, that's the end of consciousness. There is no life after death, there is no soul. We just rot and are gone. But actually, any honest scientist should admit that consciousness is the greatest mystery of science, and that we don't know exactly how it works. The brain's involved in it in some way, but we're not sure how. It could be that the brain generates consciousness the way a generator makes electricity. If you hold to that paradigm, then of course you can't believe in life after death. When the generator's broken, consciousness is gone. But it's equally possible that the relationship, and nothing in neuroscience rules it out, that the relationship is more like the relationship of the TV signal to the TV set. And in that case, when the TV set is broken, of course, the TV signal continues. And this is the paradigm of all the spiritual traditions, that we are immortal souls, temporarily incarnated in these physical forms to learn, to grow, and to develop. And really, if we want to know about this mystery, the last people we should ask are materialist inductionist scientists. They have nothing to say on the matter at all.
Okay, so that's that one. So basically, his comment is the scientists don't understand consciousness, and governments don't understand consciousness. So they want to
push us into robots, that we have no imagination, we have no consciousness, we have no connection to the divine, which is totally false and incorrect. Geez, I'm getting, hang on here, technical.
Okay.
Speech, to call for and demand another right to be recognized, and that is the right of adult sovereignty over consciousness. There's a war on consciousness in our society, and if we as adults are not allowed to make sovereign decisions about what to experience with our own consciousness while doing no harm to others, including the decision to use responsibly ancient and sacred visionary plants, then we cannot claim to be free in any way. And it's useless for our society to go around the world imposing our form of democracy on others while we nourish this rot at the heart of society and we do not allow individual freedom over consciousness. It may even be that we're denying ourselves the next vital step in our own evolution by allowing this state of affairs to continue, and who knows, perhaps our immortal destiny as well.
Okay, so we have one little quick snippet on this and we'll go on here.
I missed some of that because of all this food distribution.
Ground control, what was that?
She said she missed some of all the food distribution.
I know that. That's great. That's why I'm over here, so you're not over there. That's what I'm talking about. Ah, geez, let me get... Okay, here we go.
Imagine a society more different from the society of ancient Egypt than our society today. We hate visionary states in this society. In our society, if we want to insult somebody, we call them a dreamer. In ancient societies, that was praise. And we have erected huge apparatuses of armed bureaucracies who will invade our privacy, who will break down our doors, who will arrest us, who will send us to prison, sometimes for years, for possessing even small quantities of psilocybin or substances like DMT, whether in its smokable form or in the ayahuasca brew. And yet, ironically, DMT is, we now know, a natural brain hormone. We all have it in our bodies. It's just that its function remains unknown for lack of research. And it's not as though our society is opposed in principle to altered states of consciousness. I mean, billions are being made by the unholy alliance of psychiatrists and big pharma in over-prescribing drugs to control so-called syndromes like depression or attention deficit disorder in teenagers. And we have a love affair in our society with alcohol. We glorify this most boring of drugs, despite the terrible consequences that it often has. And of course, we love our stimulants, our tea, our coffee, our energy drinks, our sugar, and huge industries are built around these substances, which are valued because of the way they alter consciousness. But what all these approved altered states of consciousness have in common is that none of them contradict or conflict with the basic state of consciousness valued by our society, which I would call the alert problem-solving state of consciousness, which is good for the more mundane aspects of science. It's good for the prosecution of warfare. It's good for commerce. It's good for politics. But I think everybody realizes that the promise of a society over-monopolistically based upon this state of consciousness has proved hollow, and that this model is no longer working, that it's broken in every possible sense that a model can be broken, and urgently we need to find something to replace it.
Finally. So the reason I showed you this is because a lot of us today are not into our imagination, we're not into consciousness, and as Graham Hancock said, and I agree with him, we're missing the aspect of using our mind. When I do my guided imageries, I take people all over the universe because we're literally a thought away from anything. And so we miss this aspect, and so we want to go back in space and time and look and see what else we can learn from other people, learn how we can use the labyrinth to maybe do this for ourselves on a regular basis to build our consciousness back up, our imagination back up. So we all know today our basic problem is a lot of people are mad because you don't have time to be friends anymore. And we don't have time to be friends because we have information overload. You might have seen me come in, and I'm off balance sometimes, but I have two cell phones, and I have one because one's a beautiful camera, and the other one's my BlackBerry. And everybody, even Hillary Clinton has reported, had more than one item that she was caught for. So we have too many things to do, and we have not enough time to go within, and not enough time to relax, and not enough time to hear the inner spirit talking to us. And so we might remember this folk. And according to the Bible, Jesus used to walk in the desert. Why? Because he wanted to quiet the mind. He wanted to have peace. He wanted to be able to go within. He wanted to hear the messages that he was receiving. And although this was in Gethsemane, he was still praying in the garden back out in his time. So he loved nature to receive the inputs and the ideas and the feelings that nature would give to him. A lot of us don't do that today. Here's our old buddy Mark Twain. What's he have to say? He said, golf is a good walk spoiled. And so we want to talk tonight. Is that not true? So we want to talk tonight about a different kind of walk. And we want to talk about labyrinths. And we want to talk about how they work for a walk to meditate, to develop our consciousness, to be out in nature. So a labyrinth was an elaborate structure designed, and I'm speaking in tongues tonight because I don't know how to pronounce these people. So nobody can help me here if I have a witness. Who?
Daedalus.
Daedalus is good. You got a Cupid doll for you from the middle shelf. That's great.
That's king.
He's a king, yeah.
Knossos.
That's as good in Crete.
Knossos.
All right, yeah. And Kassos. So it was a function was to hold a mentor eventually killed by the hero. Who's this?
Theseus.
This guy here was on a roll. So this guy here was so cunningly made the labyrinth that he barely can escape after he built it. And this is a silver coin from the Costco's? Or is that Costco?
Costco.
Yeah. And this was about 400 BC. So in the island of Crete, they have all these mountains there, and they had these underground caves. And so the mentor was a combination of a man and an animal. So I have a couple different shots. And so this is one of them, and this is the labyrinth to try to hide this animal down below to kill some of these people coming in. So we can see this buffed up Minotaur here. He's buffed up coming off of Magic Mike from the movie you might have saw, but we know that he's going to get killed too. And notice here in the string trick, notice he has some string coming up from the ground in case he gets lost to know how to get back up. That's it. That's like Mark Twain or something. And so he has a sword. Here's our old buddy hiding back in there. And then this is the killing of the Minotaur. And so they had these different kinds of labyrinths. Now, I need to be very clear. Labyrinths are a one path in and a one path out. I heard the M word used earlier tonight, and this is not a maze. And I'll tell you why in a couple minutes. So even in a more spiritual base, you have the chakras. You go from the red, the orange, the yellow, the green in for your heart, the blue to the throat, purple, violet here, and some people use crystal up on the crown. These are also some other pictures of different kinds of labyrinths. And tonight I'm going to show you all kinds of pictures to stimulate your thinking so you can get some ideas. And I have a list of all these labyrinths in town here so you can walk them if you want to. So this basically is another form of meditation. This is a different kind of walk, and it's one path in and one path out. The journey along the labyrinth could represent one's own personal journey towards inner wisdom. Now, a lot of people don't like to do that, but that's what this is for. This one here, the labyrinths date back to the 100 BCs, but the Cretes, of course, had about 400 BC. Google put one on their campus for some reason in about 2011. Now, this particular labyrinth is very basic. There's stones, there's no maintenance to do, and this is on Mount Shasta in California. I like this, but there's some problems with this one. There are several religions which incorporate the use of labyrinths. One example of religion which incorporates use of labyrinth is Judaism. This religion includes the tree of life known as the Kabbalah, which resembles the elongated labyrinth. Another example is the Hopi religious tradition, which they call the medicine wheel, also represents a labyrinth. Now, the thing I like about this one is it's out in nature. There's all kinds of trees out here. It's beautiful. But take a look. You're going to have to be a midget to walk this because look how narrow the channels are. And unbeknownst to these people that build this, this thing is going to grow sometimes. And it's going to get big and you're going to have to bring the mower up there. And it's not a bush hog. You know, how are you going to get through all this stuff? But it's beautiful and it's inviting for people to come up and please walk me. Labyrinths are temples that enhance the balance and bring a sense of the sacred, a place where we can confirm our unity with the cosmos, awaken our vital force, and elevate our consciousness. These structures are space-time temples where we can behold realities that, oddly enough, transcend space and time. The orientation, form, and geography of labyrinths has symbolic as well as spatial importance and it is a mirror of the divine. See, when people come in, they're down here in Egypt, and that's what bothered me. This particular labyrinth, I like this because there's no maintenance here. It's just a bunch of stones. But notice some of the channels here. See, there's some room to walk, and I'll show you the importance of that later. It's a simple centerpiece, a simple beginning. You have trees here. It's peace and quiet. You can come in and walk this. Because I was in two small labyrinth groups in town, and we did them on the full moon and the new moon. In the summer, we had to be out at 8:30 in the morning because we'd have the vapors about 9:30. We'd be sweating. Now, here's what a maze is, and here's the problem with the maze. If you take a look at the maze, you have basically, there's a dead end here, there's a dead end there, there's a dead end there, there's a dead end there, here. There's not one path. You get confused when you go through that. And the maze is left brain for the rational, and the labyrinth is basically right brain or creative. So the mazes are quite interesting, but they're dead ends. And this is very short, it's not very tall, so you can kind of cheat and see where you're going. Labyrinth is a continuous path, not a puzzle. The challenge in walking a labyrinth is to let go of trying to see ahead and simply follow the path. You relinquish control. Now the problem with this labyrinth is it's a beautiful thing, and it might be in sand, so you're either a basic midget walking up here, or it's very narrow, and as you walk, you're going to be kicking the sand up on the stone, so there's a cleanup committee there. But it's beautifully done. If you take your drone up over it and take a look at it, it's very inviting, but it's kind of small to walk in. The labyrinth walking is a type of meditation which includes indoors or outdoors walking pathways. They don't just have one single path leading in or out. Now this is up. Just jump in.
Yeah. I remember this guy here. You were up at the who was that guy speaking?
That's your water right there.
Who was the guy speaking there last week?
Jim Mars.
Jim Mars. Yeah, Jim Mars. What's your name?
J.R.
J.R.
Yeah.
Who shot you?
Hey, that's your water.
So this is a church up here I'll talk to later, but this is a beautiful place. Now you'll start to notice in the center they have six roses. And they also have what they call switchbacks here, how you go one direction or the other, and that's how you balance the hemispheres on your brain by changing the path as you go around it. We had a couple people that joined me up there, and then when they came into the church, which I'll talk about later, it was very beautiful, it was very peaceful, and there's all kinds of gems like this all over the city we don't know anything about. Yeah? Okay. Also, the problem we have when we walk the labyrinths on new moon or full moon, when it rains, what are we supposed to do? Well, we go to an indoor labyrinth so we can walk it and experience it. I like this for many different reasons. Walking the labyrinth is believed to suspend consciousness, thought, and quiet the mind, thus enabling the walker to meditate. And that's what we're talking about, meditation and consciousness. A common method for walking the labyrinth is to poise a question. So if you have any kind of issues or problems, you poise a question before you go into the labyrinth. The labyrinth, you then walk to the path contemplating, and also as you're walking in, that's your past. When you get to the center, that's the present moment, and as you come out, then you're basically walking to your future and looking for and feeling the answers you're getting. Now, I like this labyrinth for many reasons. First of all, the guy here is walking on grass. I have some labyrinths around town that are very hard and very uncomfortable. Yeah, so he can walk over here in the dirt. But notice a little symbology in this one. You see right here? He's walking down into the labyrinth for that experience. Now obviously, unless he's blind, you know, he's going to see the centerpiece. And then when he's done, he's going to come back out and he's going to come up out of the labyrinth because of that little change in elevation. You notice there's houses here, there's green grass, it's out, there's fresh air. That's what a good outdoor labyrinth will do. It allows you to walk and experience and be in a meditative state. I have mixed feelings about this one, but there's more than one way to draw your labyrinth. You can choose from a simple design as well as more complex type. There's room for your interpretation. If you're a creative, you can even try different shapes, such as hearts, crosses, and squares. So the problem we have with this labyrinth, obviously, is flowers, which means they're seasonal. Somebody's got to come in there with one of those things to clean it up or some kind of mower to try to clean up the path. And you might be knocking down some of the flowers. Now, I don't want to discount this because it's a beautiful labyrinth, but again, it's only seasonal because of the various flowers they have. I like this one. Labyrinths invite a number of different purposes, ritual, prayer, guidance, meditation are just a few, which differ depending on the individual. Although they can be used many different ways, the right method of using a labyrinth consists of following the pathway towards the center, pausing to pray, seek guidance in the center, then following the same pathway back out again. The key is to let the whole thing unfold. Now, the thing I like about this is we see this, it looks like it's in the woods. We see a couple little places you can sit down if you want to, but you have a little starting point, you have a center, hardly any maintenance at all. The channel's kind of okay, I like 4 feet. But this is, it's out in nature, and you're very open to all the ideas and inspiration that are within us that can come out when we quiet the mind. Now, if you have no money, this is one to take a look at for many different reasons. The labyrinth generally consists of a single winding path that represents a seeker's life to date, the central element of resting place that represents the present, the path leading out of the labyrinth that represents the future. Now, take a look at a couple of these things. First of all, we have a nice little, they ain't spared, no, these are not made out of plastic here. So they have a nice entranceway. This girl might be little, but it's still 4 feet high, so you don't quite always have the way in the future on where you're going. So if any of you ever gone through Fort Worth up to Amarillo on 289 at the nighttime, you're hoping that you're going in the right way, but as long as you see the signs, 289, you know you're okay. So that's good. The trees are all around you, so you have privacy. Now, anytime at Christmas, if you see the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, sometimes they do the living Christmas tree. So look at all these aliens up here. You see all these people here? They're coming all the way up around the top. So part of this experience in the center is to go up around and then come back down again. You get a different view. You're walking in as your past. You come into the center to relax and pray. This time you're going up over everything. And then you're walking back down, walking back out. You have a great experience. I don't know how they keep this trim. I was thinking a military helicopter upside down. Because how do you clean all this up? But if you're doing this, you have enough money. What do you think, Jay?
It's beyond me at the moment.
That's right. They have some more water there.
Mexicans.
All right, here's another problem you have. I was raised over the Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And where you were too?
Over here.
Okay, you're in Ohio? So I was born in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. We live 25 miles north. And those of you that are familiar with the book, Men Are From Mars, Women Are From Venus, I literally went to Mars High School. So I'm one of those guys that are from Mars. And so we went down to a buffet on Route 8, which is about 20 miles north of Pittsburgh. And my grandfather was there, and my mother was there, and she was the oldest. And my grandfather, John, he had his sister Mary there. Well, Mary wanted to look at every little item on the buffet. And so my father said to my mother, he said, Mary's got that big feed sack on tonight. And so sometimes she was holding the whole line back because she wanted to see everything. So each participant starts walking and praying along, giving space to the person in front and behind. If someone is walking very slowly, it is okay to pass. It's not okay to ask them to move faster, or I'll show you a picture in a sec what some other people do. Once people reach the center, they may stay as long as they wish. You can see we have a nice center put. But see what happens when you have these small, narrow channels? And I know if any of you guys ever rode White Rock Lake in the old days with bicycles, you know, it's always passing on the left. And if you don't like them, you kind of kick them on the side here and push them off. And that's what I'm happening here. This little girl here, she's all primmed up, and she's thinking about jumping off the diving board. Well, this girl here is not having any. She wants to get moving, so she just pushes her off. So in a labyrinth, you're not supposed to push people. That's why it's important that you have a big channel so people can pass. Here's the labyrinth that has escaped from the stress, materialism, etc. Walking the path is a way to concentrate on things other than possession. One of my favorite gyms in town was up in the northwest corner of Forest Lane in Preston. There was used to be called Bally's or President's. And I liked it because it had a big spa, but it had a cold plunge, and it had all kinds of stuff. But it took me 2 hours to get there and change, to work out, to do all the water aerobics, to shower off and get back in. But you also have these finger labyrinths. And with a finger labyrinth, you get the same effect by giving it the finger, you know, walking all the way around there. I have a psychotherapist friend, and she has a white plastic one like this, and she uses it all the time with her clients. So you don't have to walk outside, you don't have to walk inside, you can also give it the finger. Labyrinth walking can be helpful if used as a complementary method of decreasing stress and enabling relaxation. You'll notice down here, this is in, looks like Clark, Mass, Oregon. Now, the only problem I have with this, it has a lot of privacy, it's outdoors, but take a look at the rocks they use. If you notice the rocks there, they're kind of rough. And so if you've come out of surgery and you're with a four-wheeler or a cane, you might have, you know, you might go over and fall down and go, boom. Beautiful job. Beautiful. But it's just, is it practical? This is over in Germany. This is another little quickie labyrinth out of someplace out over there. So when you walk through the labyrinth, you want to give thanks and notice the feelings, thoughts, and every sensation accompany you from an in-body way to express the gracefulness. So this is another form of labyrinth that's outside. It doesn't have to be fancy. I like this one. I walked the labyrinth and nothing happened. What did I do wrong? You receive something, walk the labyrinth again, or take time to reflect. So the problem we have with our information overload is that we have too much stuff we're thinking about. And can we actually relax to allow the energies and the feelings to come in? So my suggestion is walk it a couple times and see what happens. I like this one because the stonework is fabulous. The mower can cut this real easy. You really have no big maintenance problems on cleaning this up. And I got a problem with this one. Why are you using the labyrinth? The labyrinth facilitates movement and can face whatever you need to face there. It is not doctrinal or dogmatic. The only dogma you will need to meet in the labyrinth is your own. Now notice this labyrinth. It's elevated. So you can imagine yourself when you're trying to meditate and you got to make sure you're walking on the grass. And what happens if you're not walking on the grass? You fall over and you get your ankle sprained, or you get mad, or you say some unpleasant words. And how do you mow the thing? I mean, how do you mow that without getting clipping on the end of it? Then you got to go through with a big, one of those big fans they have in the bayou or something like that to blow with all the grass cuttings. So there's a lot of work done on this, but in my opinion, it's just not that practical. So here's some of the local labyrinths, and I have a list of them over here. Help yourself to them, and we'll just show them real quick. This is a church we saw earlier. This is the Episcopal Church, LBJ on Hillcrest, the Spring Valley, northwest corner. This is the one that's inside. This lady here, they dedicated to. The start of the labyrinth is right over here. And this is a six roses right in the center. Again, a lot of switchbacks, which help you balance your hemisphere. Beautiful place. Plenty of parking. This place here, I didn't even know where it's at. It's on the tollway to Mockingbird to Inwood. It's on the northwest corner of Inwood. Mockingbird is actually in the kitchen of the church. This church looks like it's on lockdown because they have all kinds of keys because it's wide open. Nice little church. And they have a brochure that they give out because they're really supporting their labyrinth. And so this was a nice place to walk. Again, you see the six roses in there. You see the switchbacks. This one here is the Northway Christian Church. You get down 75 to Northwest Highway West. You'll see the cemetery, Hillcrest Memorial Park on the north side. And the south side, you'll see this fancy Christian church. You have to go around the block, come into the back parking lot. In the northeast corner, there's this four-car garage that they've turned into a little, all-purpose room. I would have never known about this. This one here is kind of interesting. This is a Richmond College. Yeah, that's good. Thank you. And many more. That's great. Okay, so LBJ North in Greenville to Walnut Hill in the southeast corner. This is the north entrance of Richmond College. So if you've ever been up there, you go down south, and on the right-hand side or west side, there's beautiful pond or beautiful lake. And as you do that, there's beautiful trees all the way around. Down here is a parking lot, and there's a big tree there you can sit under. The students, when I walk it, I'll show you. I have a kind of a walking cane that I use, and so they're seeing a bunch of crazy people in there walking it. But the problem with this is a beautiful one, but they have some wire in the back here, some piping. And if you're not careful, you'll trip over the piping. So the labyrinth here is very hard. Now this thing is nice, and it's right about here, but the problem is it's made out of concrete. So you're trying to put your finger in there and walk the labyrinth and you tear it up. So maybe they're trying to get blood donations. I don't know what they're doing. So it's nice, but it's just not like the plastic ones because it's not very comfortable. Now, this is Children's Medical Hospital. You know, it's not quite like the airport with the TSA people, work on you. But when you come into the Children's Hospital and park and you go into the lobby, they want to check you out to make sure you're not bringing any viruses in or anything. So after you go through that, then you have to walk down the stairs. Then they have their cafeteria. Then this is where the people sit here. But the problem is you have this road here and the old parkland. The new one is not, they're using a new one across the street. But the old parkland here, so you got cars going down there. But there's so much peace and quiet around here that they come out and eat. And here's your six roses, and here's the switchbacks again. No maintenance. You know, the rain today would just clean it right up. So it's just a beautiful place, and they spent a lot of money. But it's basically for the people, because the outsiders like myself have to go through all this stuff to get in there. Here it is in good old SMU, Perkins School of Theology. You come in off of 75, the Mockingbird. There's a big road up the center. The football field is here. There's a museum here, and there's that fancy water thing. There you go, halfway up and over to the left, and here's Perkins. So these two buildings are connected. I've seen guys out here doing texting in the middle of the day. We got students walking there.
I went to a class this morning with Dr. Kirby.
Really?
Who ran this for many, many years.
Right. You notice here we only have five rose petals, and that's okay. It's a smaller one. You see hardly any maintenance, beautifully done, peace and quiet on a beautiful college campus. It's just great. This one here is a jewel, and there's a lot of stuff going on here. This is on 75 East on Spring Valley to Jupiter. It's on the northwest corner of Jupiter and Spring Valley. This is a Catholic church. Now, this is an idea they do in downtown Europe, and they have some kind of, John, do you know what they call that, an honorarium or something like that? Jump in anytime you want to. I know you're eating. So this is five blocks high, and they have the urns when you die.
Oh, that's a columbarium.
Very good. Let's pass her some more bread here, right here. So they have it five stories high, and you can put your urns of your loved ones in this. Now the problem is, see, this is a beautiful one. Look at the grass. You can clean that up. But see, here's the problem. You're walking into this thing, and all of a sudden the angels are starting to sing at you. And I'm looking up at the tall buildings all over the place. Who is that? And I can't figure it out. Well, they have some kind of a, I couldn't see the beam, but they have little outdoor speakers, and it's a nice effect. You walk in. But the problem is, you know, since their loved ones are there, we got strange people walking in here looking at their loved ones. I'm trying to walk the labyrinth, you know. Beautiful. So I parked on this side, and you walk through, and you have a hallway, and then you walk right here. The other way, you have to come through the church. So if you get on Google Maps, you can see this from Google Maps, but nobody really knows it's there unless you're a Catholic. This one here is University Park, United Methodist Church, Tollway South. Well, I'm sharing, there's no extra charge now. You get down the Tollway to Northwest Highway, East and Northwest Highway to Preston, south of Preston, six blocks down to Carruth Road. As you turn left going east, you'll see this beautiful church. Now, this is a church, and this is the administrative thing, and this is their labyrinth with all the trees, very peaceful. And right across the street is Smith Park. So when you go down there during the week, you'll see all these kids out there playing. But the problem is, even though this is a beautiful one, you got all kinds of traps in here you're going to be careful of. They have piping again, and right in here you can get really tripped up if you're not aware of it, and they have a little announcement here. So this is a beautiful place. It's very inviting to come in and just walk it. This one here is in Carrollton, Holy Covenant United Methodist of Carrollton. You basically go on George Bush up on Josie. You go up to Frankfurt, and on the east side, there's this nice big pond. And then on Peter Colony's Road, they have a pond over here. There's a lot of trees in here, very narrow, very small, a bunch of benches, but it's nice and it's inviting, and it's in the Carrollton area. This one here is in McKinney Community Center. You go up on 75 to El Dorado, between El Dorado and McKinney High School. When the community center is on the east, you go to the end of the parking lot. Down in the middle, there will be a trail, and the trail will take you down into this little labyrinth. Now, it's kind of tough to see the blue here, but you can kind of get an idea of the walkway. The problem is you're hearing basically the 75 road traffic, and I have a friend that flutes, plays the flute when he's in there. Yeah, well, I'm showing you one off the planet here at the end, and we'll get into that. Now, this is the list of some of the ones we have, and I have them all over here. Now, the ones in Addison, there are two special parks in Addison. One is Celestine Park. I don't know if anybody knows where that is, off Beltline, west of Preston on the south side. Well, this one here, I have pictures with me, but somebody spent a lot of money, because you walk up the marble staircases, they have the poetry. And, you know, most of us are not into poetry, but they have these marble steps there with beautiful poetry. And just two or three stages, but it makes you think and feel. Then you go across the thing. Then they got a sundial up here like a Mayan mountain, like a Mayan temple. And they have a sundial there. And if you don't know what you're doing, two people stand on the end of the sundial, and you can have that echo chamber back and forth.
So I was doing a meditation one night, and somebody was trying to interfere with doing a wedding. So there's all kinds of people doing that. So it's a beautiful place. I call this Pagan Park. It's on Keller Springs, west of the tollway, down to the Keller Springs light, and it's on the northwest corner. So this guy up in Addison, his mother was basically a pagan or a white witch. And he dedicated this park to his mother. And it's a beautiful walking park, a lot of fountains, and it's just a beautiful place. It's not necessarily a labyrinth, but it's up there. And if you're ever up in that area, it's just a beautiful place. So we're going to do labyrinths around the planet. I just want to give you a quick running show of some of the things we have around the planet that you can kind of take a look at. First of all, I have a friend when I Thanksgiving go up to Hot Springs Village, and I used to buy my crystals from a bunch of people up there, and they're the Coleman brothers. Hot Springs is basically the biggest place in the world to get your diamonds, your crystals. And so Gladys and Charlie, they work on the Coleman brothers. One talks to one talks to the other. So right here is a 500-pound crystal that they have in their front room, and now they have a lot of crystals up here you can't see from Russia and all over the world. But the real gem, I call Gladys, and I tell her I'm coming in, and she screams out to Charlie, her husband, Charlie, clean off the labyrinth because Lipinski's coming in. But what they've done is, in their backyard, they have this, they say they have 1,000 crystals out here. They're obviously the centerpiece, the little beginning. Very small, but not too many people know about it, but it's a very different feeling. You're out in nature. And because of all these trees up in Hot Springs Village, that's where they get all the leaves all over the place. Interesting place. This is location unknown, but notice the simplicity of beauty. The trees around here, the white little rocks they have, and the grass is growing up, easy maintenance probably. These are probably the size of a lawnmower this guy has. This guy doesn't want to stand up, but he wants to sit down and just relax. And what's wrong with that? It's very nice, very simple, very beautiful. This one here is in Houston. Not only did they build this labyrinth, but notice the three little fountains they did. Very nice touch. This one's similar to the other church we saw in Highland Park, but this is up in Boston Commons. Notice all the trees around, very narrow channels, but it's still nice to walk, even though there's probably 1,000 people up there. Not too many people are walking the labyrinth all the time. This one's out in Davis, California. Again, this guy was semi-selfing himself, but he had the six petals there. This church has gone overboard. Inside the church, they have this labyrinth. As you're coming into church, I guess, and notice the six there. You notice the switchbacks here. But look outside. They did another one outside. And so we got the street there. But look how beautiful this is. No maintenance here. You can sit down here, relax, and take your turn, whatever you want to do. I like this one. Simply because when people live by water, the water takes a negative energy out of you. Plus, we have lost not that loving feeling, but remember when we were kids, we used to walk barefoot all the time. And we don't walk barefoot anymore, so this guy here took off their sandals. They walk in here, and who cares if it's wet sand or dry sand? They're getting to walk here. The ocean is out here. They spared no expense on these logs here to have your entrance point. But it's simple. It's easy to build. There's no maintenance. You get to feel the sand or Mother Earth beneath your feet, and obviously you have the ocean out there, which is really nice. Here's another nice one in San Rafael, California. Polished stones, no maintenance. This may be a fountain here you can sit on. Notice how wide the channels are, so when you're passing, you don't have to push somebody out of the way. This one here is a problem. It's a corporate one, and they're putting down the chalk. So if somebody tries to cut the grass, they'll be blowing the chalk all over the place. But it's a gigantic labyrinth they have out there for their people that actually want to walk it. Here's another one. This is Episcopal Church, also in California. No maintenance on this one. Colored stone, beautiful rock work. Centerpiece, obviously. Hardly any maintenance at all on this one. I like this because of the color. This guy's proud of his creation. A lot of trees outside. But notice how narrow these channels are. And I don't know whether this is just decoration or whether it's a seat or something. But somebody spent a lot of work on this, and it's beautiful, very inviting. This is in Erie, Pennsylvania, north where I grew up at. Notice it's just wide open spaces, a little bit different design, and it's kind of narrow, but it's kind of a nice design. It's outside. I like this guy here. He's in Vermont. He's got little rocks here at the end points, and it's very easy to walk around, no particular maintenance to do, and it's just a nice walk, and it looks like it might be on some farmland.
and maybe people know about it, maybe they don't, but this guy spent some time and did a real nice job. I have to put this person in the healing circle because this is in Yosemite. It's a snow lab, and they did a perfect design. But what is this over here? Is this just a black mat, or could this be the bogs coming in, or actually the water? So just like the sandcastles on the beach, you know, you make them, and the water comes in and destroys them. That's what's going to happen here. In the simple practicality, when you start walking in these things, you're going to put footprints in, and you're going to kind of overlap, and you may not be seeing the lines. But it's a beautiful job, and it could be done in a couple hours if you really want to walk it. Now, this is what I'm talking about. We got the ocean out there, and you're in Scotland, and they're drinking pints all the time. So they're taking their bottles and say, we don't need to spend thousands of dollars. We'll just put our bottles out there. Now, if they've been drinking too much, they'll kick the bottle kind of thing. But they still have a simple labyrinth that's on the hard land. There's no maintenance, and they can just put the bottles back whenever they want. This is in a church. Now, two things. I go to any church in Dallas, and notice how the straight lines are here. Most labyrinths have a curvature. So the labyrinths that have straight lines are for the bottom four chakras, the base, the sexual area, the solar plexus, and the heart. The heart is the middle one. When you see labyrinths with the curve to it, that's for the upper four chakras, the heart, throat, third eye, pituitary, and the crown. That's more spiritual, more energized. This is very simple and sweet in the forest. Very simple, again, very narrow channels, but it's there, it's beautiful, it's peaceful, and you obviously be open to all kinds of messages when you walk it. I could have a problem with this one too. This is in the Netherlands. Nice job. Spent a lot of money on this, but guess what? The rocks are not flat. I had a picture of this with a mother and her three kids, and they're running around like a bunch of hyenas. And the mother's concerned if they're going to play, and if you fall off this one, although the water's not deep, you may have some serious damage because you don't have grass, you have stones. So this is, it's beautiful, but it's just not practical. But there's a river on the other side of this, and that's why they did that there. This is nice. It's in Finland. It's simple. The rocks, the channels are a little narrow, but this doesn't look like, you know, you have a farmer's fence here, and you got stones. It's beautiful. And so they, once you build it, you're done. There's no maintenance. Here in Hong Kong for the seminary, they did some funny things. They have the city over here, but they're in a park, and they got these little white stones. So I don't know whether the seminarians have to walk in their bare feet to get a little religion in there or not. But it's very beautiful. It's very simple. They even have a little surrounding rocks around it. This one is in Salzburg. I thought it was Germany. I was told it's actually Austria. So yes. The hills were alive. So notice, these are just like the little light bags used at Christmas time. Notice the darkness and the simplicity and the beauty, the simplistic beauty about this whole thing. One path in, one path out. So it's another way to experience what a labyrinth's all. Is everybody okay? Because the air conditioner turned on, I'm fine. Anybody have a problem? Now these people at the Notre Dame, notice the specialness of this one here. The six roses, notice the patterns, the hardwood. They spared no limitation on expense. Okay, burn, baby, burn. So beautiful thing, and you can do this if you want to, especially in an abbey or in a church. This one is an old place in Sweden. Here's a basic design. I'm not sure it's a ruin, so I don't know whether they open it up for people or not. This one has a big story behind it because this is in France. And this, they took 60 years to build this. If you ever want to watch it on the History Channel, it's a fascinating story. They had to do all kinds of architectural marvels to make the roof and all that. The problem is they had three cardinals that ran this. They had the Holy Wars going on, and they were always beating the heck out of the people to get more money. And so in order to offset that, the new people, they said, before you can come to church, you may want to walk the labyrinth to get all that anger out of your system. But notice how beautiful this is, and these are specially designed architectural marvels for that particular time. It's a beautiful church, but it took 60 years to build it. So here's what we do, the steps to take on a walk. We set our intention or ask our question, what's our issue we're going to work on? The next thing we're going to do, we're going to begin our walk at our own pace. We'll stop wherever we want, maybe each of the four directions or whatever. That's their past. Then you're going to come into the center. That's actually your past. You're coming into the center next, and that's your present. And then as you come out, that's your new future, and hopefully you'll get the answer to your question or intention. Now, some of the crazy people I walk with do all kinds of things, like they play an instrument like a flute. Some people do the Lord's Prayer. Some will honor the four directions, north, south, east, west. Some will tone, hum, or sing. When doing a switchback, I have one lady that's more colorful than me in dressing. And so she'll do the all kinds of different crazy motions, but sometimes she'll spin around clockwise or counterclockwise. There's no right or wrong. And more tuned into the sounds and elements of nature. There's a certain time in the day when you go from the day sound to the night sound. And when you get to the night sound, you hear the crickets. And I've had birds fly over us and things like that when we're ready, and the elementals all over the place. So this, I don't know if this is Photoshopped or not. It looks pretty good. And it's beautiful, but it's very narrow. But if you look, you come in here to come in here, but you see you got a secret passage that takes you out, and that's not really a labyrinth. The labyrinth wants you to come back out and walk out. So somebody did this, whether it's Photoshopped or not, it's still a beautiful picture. This is Unity of Dallas, God bless you. We had John Barnes, he made a round labyrinth here in the north parking lot, and he made a straight line one here. This used to be where White House is off of Forest Lane, west of Hillcrest. I built one in here, he built two up there. In the meantime, we've been having a church for 30 years and somebody's not been paying off the note. So we sold 3.8 acres from this on this side over to the end, and that's destroyed all three of our labyrinths. So I built a labyrinth and I knew we were gonna sell the property. And so I had the White River rock and I put some signs out here and I was going to put marble steps down, I was going to put flowers down, I was going to put a fountain and all that, but we knew we were going to sell it, we had to stop. So one of my guys made a sign because we have people, 12 units on the east side of our labyrinth, and they have their dogs. And their dogs like to walk our labyrinth because they're putting love offerings down in our labyrinth. So he said, labyrinth ahead, come linger a while, find grace with each step or some peace or a smile. Feel free to bring Fido or Lass to your spot, but mind puppy manners, thank you a lot. And that's by Anonymous, whoever that is. This sheet of paper is available for you up here on how to walk a labyrinth. I put the steps up on a tree there. This is mine. There's nothing fancy about this, but it's a basic labyrinth pattern. Forest Lane is here. These are 4 foot, so you can walk past each other. Here's the center. This is a start. So it's nothing, you know, $1 million one, but it's simple and you can walk it. And we mow the lawn over there all the time, but they've already messed up that whole area now with construction. This is one of my, canes that I walk with. This is a big crystal. This is the straight line labyrinth we had on the west side. The other one was over here. A friend of mine, Carla Bass, took this with her iPhone and it was a Aura camera photo. So this shows after I walked. Of course, I'm still doing paperwork here. It showed it what it looked like, so you can, you know, take or leave that. Now, this is a new one with high energy, and let me tell you about this real quick. This is the Mayan labyrinth. It uses pyramid technology of the ancient Maya for a frequency-generating machine. So you come in on the red, and you go all the way around. You come here, you go the other direction. You come back here. Now, here's where it changed. Nobody goes in here. But as you come out, this in the blue, you're coming out, you're walking all the way around, and you come out that way. So, I'll get another picture in a second. If you notice, that labyrinth had circles, and the circle has a lot of symbols to it. Target uses it in for their corporate. This is from the Rancher book, and that's circles. Circles also represent portals. And Atlantis, whether we like it or not, agree with it or not, had the circles. Atlantis had the three circles. That's a symbol for Atlantis. These are supposedly the people who lived there. Now, this is what the different circles. Now, when you have this, when you basically get your drone up over the top of it and you run this, this is where the people that are doing prayer work are in number one. Number two over here is for healing. Number three is for Tai Chi or movement of some kind. Number four is for the musical instruments, like a flute. Number five is for the drumming, is here. And number six down here is toning, which is another form of meditation. So when you have people walking this, and we put incense in here at the beginning, and you have people walking this, if you come up with your drone over top, you have like the movements of a watch. And so it's very unique, and it develops a certain kind of energy. So I'm looking to see if I can put this. This is Unity. I'm looking to see if I can put it over here, But we got to do other restoration work though, so it'll probably be over here. So that's a pretty good, it's a good challenge for me, but that's the latest and greatest. So, kind of, I'm bringing the airplane in now. So the idea here is to find a labyrinth, sense your intention, mention something that you're grateful for, step into the labyrinth or pass and start walking to the center. At the center, pause to reflect this present moment and then leave whenever you are ready. As you walk back out into your new future, continue to be in the moment. Remember, we're the artists of our reality. We forget that. We're creative beings and we forget that. Now, one little more from our buddy. Okay, here.
To save the lungs of our planet. And this is perhaps why shamans from the Amazon are now mounting a kind of reverse missionary activity. When I've asked shamans about the sickness of the West, they say it's quite simple. You guys have severed your connection with spirit. Unless you reconnect with spirit and do so soon, you're going to bring the whole house of cards down around your heads and ours.
Okay, that's this was as Graham Hancock. It's on. They don't allow him to talk about this anymore because it's consciousness. So the labyrinth is a way to walk and to meditate, develop your consciousness and your imagination. That's what this whole thing is about. And that's all, folks. And I got my protective leaf there. And that's all I have.
Stay there and answer questions. You have to stay there and answer questions.
Oh, real Jesus, Mother God, yeah. Yeah, Jana.
A movie, The Name of the Rose, with Sean Connery.
Yeah.
Have you seen it?
Yes.
Yeah, was that a labyrinth? The building called the labyrinth? There was
a movie called The Labyrinth, but I don't remember in that specific
there
movie.
Was, yeah, I think the, would you call a labyrinth that goes up staircases and all, would that, in a building, would that still be a labyrinth?
It was one path in and out, yes.
I think that's probably what the maze for a little labyrinth.
Well, I think they used the word labyrinth. I was just trying to remember.
But I think folks knew the maze because they were able to get lost, and you can't get lost in a labyrinth. So they probably were not for sloppy. But I just vaguely remember that, but I do recall that they had to use the... old technique, Cretan technique with a minotaur to find their way out of it.
Okay.
On one of your slides, the path had a place where there was a separate little circle all by itself. Do you remember that?
Was that the last one, the Maya?
No, it was early in the presentation. But instead of having these continuous circular shapes in between those where they looped around, there was one little separate dot, sort of. And I was wondering if that indicated that if you stepped off on that, you'd be stuck.
I don't remember that unless that's a green maze that I showed, the difference between a maze and a labyrinth.
It was the picture that had a hand over it.
Oh, that was a kid, yeah. He was just, it was a sunshine coming down a certain way, and he put his hands up in the air. And so it's shown his image or shadow inside of that six rows thing. If that's what you're talking about.
Well, no, it had a separate little circle spot in there that was not connected to anything.
I probably have to go back after this and just let's take a look at it together. Because, yeah, okay.
Hello, John.
How are you, man?
I'm a little confused about the definitions of maze and labyrinth. It seems like you can't get lost in these labyrinths you showed us, even if they were underground. It's just one way in, one way out. But okay. The famous labyrinth, the Minotaur, and Theseus, obviously it's hard not to get lost. So I'm trying to figure out really the definition difference.
Well, the maze is basically for the left brain, and there's all kinds of places you stop. You have to stop and go around. If you know, they have the movie out. I saw this new version of the Maze Runner, and those things were extremely high. You couldn't look over them. So maze, you have to think, and even in Harry Potter, they had a maze aspect in there because they would go down once that, and they'd stop because they couldn't go through. So a maze, again, is the left brain or the thinking brain, and you stop, you can't go. The labyrinth, when it was down below, the problem is it was dark, they hadn't been down there before, it wasn't well lit, and that's why that one slide I showed with the string, they were trying to figure out how to get in, and then they didn't know at that time it was one path in and one path out, and they were also concerned about the mentor coming up and hit them upside the head and killing them. And so they were a little bit nervous, it was a little bit dark, and they had the string theory kind of to help you take in and take out. They weren't familiar with what was involved today. I mean, we know all about these things. So
I've never heard that definition before, but it's very common. That's the official definition now.
Yeah, the labyrinth is the same path in and the same path out, because you're going your past, your present in the center, and your future when you ask that intention as you come out. The maze is basically a puzzle, or to trick you and have you use your left brain. But the labyrinth stimulates your right brain to be creative. And, you know, like I say, I have people I walk with that do all kinds of strange things, but they know it's one path in and one path out.
I have a question.
You do have the list of Metroplex labyrinths. Could you make up a list for the other ones you showed in case anybody finds themselves at any of these locales?
What do you mean, like Addison, or?
I mean, just around the world.
Finland.
Google. It's called Google.
Yeah, thank you. Well, see, the problem I have is there's hundreds of labyrinths I could show you, and I'm all probably over my hour time limit. So I wanted to give you a glimpse of some of the things around the world and some of the creativity they had, like in Austria, where they had those little lights out at nighttime. Very different, very unique. And I like the ones at the beach by the water. They were different. But, you know, to have that kind of a list, again, the idea was just Google. Just Google labyrinths of the world and see what you come up with.
Okay. Is there any list of what I would call metaphysical ahas or something that come out of the labyrinth study? Like, one of the things I can see immediately is that you go from the past to the present, but then you have to cross the past to go to the future. So that's making a statement.
Yes, that's good.
Do you have any others like that that the labyrinth has presented to you?
Well, a couple ideas real quick, and Tom, you need to tell me how much time I have here. When we walked, we had about 8 to 15 people, and John Barnes was the guy that designed our labyrinth at North Party Unity, and he would do his finger technique, and he would tell us which one goes first, and so we'd have about 8 to 15 people. The first one would go in, and they'd walk around halfway, then the second person would start to do that. We got in the center, then we opened it up, and the people that weren't there, we brought them into our circle. And then after that, as I do the meditations, we ask people for what did they saw or feel. And a lot of times what I saw was elementals peeking out of the trees. I heard other certain noises. I saw a lot of angels. We had vortexes that were coming up through there. We had some ladies that were very tuned in, and we asked ourselves, do we need to walk this anymore or not? And some said no. We were complete with this one. And so I did with two other ladies, I did this came to me, that there was a one with a straight line here on the west side and ones with a circle. So we started here and we did a figure eight, or we did an infinity symbol, and we did it 12 times, and that was our closure on those particular labyrinths, because we used to walk them all the time. Some of the ladies would get, you know, all kinds of different feelings or insights, or here's what I saw, here's what I felt. I never wrote them down though, you know.
Are there other times besides new moon and full moon that you specifically would seek to walk a labyrinth?
Those are the times, the equinoxes also, and the solstice you can do. But it's out there for you anytime. Anytime you want to get a quick hit on, I got a problem, I got an issue, let me just stop here and walk it and see what I get.
Oh, I was just wondering, what is the significance of the six roses?
That's a French symbol. They had the six roses over there, and so they put that into the center of the labyrinth. And that was their way they established that. And as you see, they've developed, as I showed you a lot of different labyrinths, we've seen even that crazy one out in Yellowstone Park, that was a basic formation. But some of the people have taken that, and they did the flowers, and they did all kinds of other things, and then the churches and all that. But they seem to have, you know, one path in, one path out, and they have the center six circles where you can stand there if you want to, and then you can go around your circle and get ideas.
It seemed like the majority of them had that same pattern.
That's a kind of a standard template for a labyrinth.
Right.
A template, but you don't have to do that. Because the one we saw at the SMU only had five because it was too small and they didn't have room to put a sixth one in. So that's like there was a joke back in 2012 about the Mayans doing a crazy calendar, and then somebody said this is really going to screw people up in the future because they couldn't finish it. You know, that was a joke back then at the time. It was kind of cute.
On the microphone, please. Right there.
Yeah, yeah, you got your hand up.
Okay,
there.
Well, I didn't know if somebody was before me or not.
No.
The one at the Transfiguration Church and the other one out on Coit and Spring Valley, Spring Valley.
The Catholic Church one?
No, it's an Episcopal.
Hillcrest North of LBJ, yeah.
They have cords, I guess, or it's like a thing that you put around you. Can you speak on the significance of that? And is that, I mean, obviously that's not going to be on the one that are out in the elements.
I'm doing a lot of thinking and researching, and this is a crazy comment, but I'll make it anyways. Long ago and far away, we had a guy in Europe that around the end of December gave some presents to kids. And now we have a multi-billion dollar Christmas simply because of that idea. And so people take the labyrinth and then they say, how can I juju it up? Like with the flowers, what can I add to? What can I take away? The one over on 75 Mockingbird and that little other church up there it was in the kitchen. They have the robes that they do, and they have the four color brochure. They're very serious about it, and it's just like in a Catholic church and other churches, they have certain robes and represent things. A lot of people wear symbols around their neck. Some of my people have all kinds of copper stuff around them, and they feel that makes them more in tune, and it's part of their ceremony, part of their expression, part of their being open to whatever they're going to get. And so they figure, a lot of people have copper bands and all kinds of stuff around them this day, and they feel that heals them, or it brings energy in or whatever. So they're adding a little bit of color or energetics to it.
Is there any way to, and have there been any studies done on how the specific geometry will affect the consciousness of the person? For instance, square corners and sharp corners, or smooth rounded corners and so forth.
The ones up at Unity I talked about, I showed the one with straight lines, and then that one church that has straight lines, and that's for the as far as we know, that's for the four chakras. The heart is the center one, so it's the base, the sexual, solar plexus, and the heart. The ones with the circles that are perfectly circle are for the higher chakras, the heart, the throat, third eye, pituitary, and the crown. So those are the slight differences there. The one I showed you on the Mayan thing, they have not, it's a whole different concept with those six little circles inside, so they're up in the energy and the frequency and all that with that little touch. And then some people are wearing jewelry and all that, but they're basically, if you remember the beginning, I showed you about eight different designs from the old Crete way that they did that. They had a circle, they didn't quite have a circle, they had a square, they had ones with the chakra colors on it, then they had the psychedelic ones that look like. And so I don't think I have a totally good answer for you, but a basic labyrinth has the circles. But people change it and they play with it to see if it does anything for it. But the main thing is you're making an intention of developing of your consciousness. I'm going to walk this, and I'm going in, this is my intention. I'm going to take my time or whatever. I'm going to get to the center, which is my present life, and then I'm going to be open for new ideas, feelings, or answers to my question. Then I'm coming back out. And so as you experience with these labyrinths, you might basically find you're getting different ideas and information by the different labyrinths you walk. And nature has so much to do with it also. If you're with a lot of trees, you get a bunch of bullfrogs. Jeremiah was a friend of mine out there making their noise. Then they basically, it adds to the whole nuance of the thing. So.
Yes.
What's with the churches? How come the churches are into this so much? This sounds like a pagan thing.
Well,
that's why I showed you all these things, because they're realizing it. It's a simple form of meditation. And we have all these churches all over town that do that. Even the SMU had it at, you know, their Perkins Chapel. The hospitals have it. People are starting to realize. You know,
I'm talking about from history, like 1700s. You showed one. Like,
well, the ideas came in, and the question is, how do we do prayer work? How do we do meditation? These people over in China or someplace else are using this. Maybe we'll bring it back, we'll walk it, we'll try it. And then it's developed from there. I don't know whether that's a good answer for what you're trying to ask.
I was thinking about the ancient roots of why one of the churches has an excuse or rationale.
Well, a lot of the ancient churches in Europe specifically are on they're on ley lines. And because they're on ley lines, they get a lot more energy. Mary Magdalene's church in France is on a magnificent ley line, and a lady friend of mine was walking in there, and she could feel her pineal being stimulated, and she could feel her throat being stimulated, and some of her lady friends thought she was crazy. She was just feeling the energy, because that particular church was on the ley lines. And so the ancients knew these things. The Druids knew these things about the ley lines, and they had their special rituals that they did all the time, and I'm saying that labyrinth was a natural progression of what they did. It seemed they liked it, it worked, it wasn't that, you know, tough to put together. I'm not happy with that answer, but that's where I'm at.
The author Dan Brown wrote about yes. a number of different elements like that. Do you know of an author who wrote about labyrinths, and did the author give it a positive spin or a negative spin?
And I come back next week.
You could, yes.
I don't have a good answer for you on that. I have some books like that. The book I just talked about, the ley lines, they talk about that. But I can't remember off the top of my head of anything about labyrinths.
Okay, well, that's our duty here, is to ask you questions. You don't
right?
have the answers.
Yeah, just jump in anytime you want to, John. That's great.
Does this relate to feng shui in any way?
I would say if it's on ley lines, possibly. Feng shui is the basic, the smooth flow of energy. And so that may be more powerful on a ley line type of thing. I've never heard those two connected, but I'm not poo-pooing that either. These guys give me a hand, or you give me the finger, man? Oh, you just... Yeah, go ahead.
What is a ley line?
Thank you. Question.
What is that?
What is a ley line?
Yes.
Oh, you're over here. Okay. Ley line is spelled L-E-Y. Oh, J.R., jump in there, man. A ley line is a... people don't like to talk about these things, but there's grid works all over our planet. You're going down the black hole. Our planet is basically a living entity. Not too many people like to hear that. So we have energy lines all over our planet, or a grid. We have grid works all over our planet. And so the ancients... I talked about Atlantis a little bit. I don't want to get down there tonight, but they knew where these energy points were. And if you look in Europe, if you want to look at Google, look at ley lines in Europe, and you'll see how many ancient churches were on these ley lines, because they're power centers, they were power points. Mm-hmm. And they could feel the energy, and they could let their people feel it. So when they walked into the church, they were feeling good or different or unique. So the ancients knew all this stuff about the grid work. And so they put these buildings on there. So a ley line is just an energy line. It's in a straight line. And you can also look, Google up, planet and grid lines or something like that.
So were the ley lines the form of energy that the ancient Celtic Druids used to pull up blue fire energy out of the ground or something, that something different?
Who did you say again now?
The ancient Celtic Druid.
Yes.
Priests were able to pull up blue fire energy out of the ground. Was that right. from the ley lines or some other form?
Let me make a funny comment to you. I had a lady friend of mine that wanted me to make a robe for me.
Thank you.
And the robe that had her made, it was a Druid robe. And so I have kind of an affinity there. So they were into the power. I don't remember the blue fire coming up, but I don't doubt that it wasn't. It was because of the ley lines. That's where the energy's at. Why should it go someplace else? But they had big magic, and they, you know. But shamans and other people know where the energy's at, and so they don't fight it. They go where the energy's at, and they do their rituals or whatever.
It's L-E-Y, right?
L-E-Y.
L-E-Y.
Yeah.
When you first started off, you talked about lack of consciousness.
Yeah.
And you talked about we're so very busy, we don't meditate. And then you went to the labyrinth, so
yeah.
Identify those. I guess I'm not too much into this, but if sometimes if I have an issue, I just get by myself and walk
right.
in the woods or
yes.
in the parks, and sometimes what I'm wrestling with, I see how to deal with it.
Right.
Is there anything different from that than going to the labyrinth?
Well, the two pictures I showed in the beginning was Jesus walking in the desert, and that was a free-form way for him to clean his mind or clear his mind and be open to any new ideas and coming into him. He also did that in the garden. And so what you're doing is also very, it's very similar because you're in nature, you're walking, you're open. And, you know, when we were kids, I don't know about you guys, but when I was kids, we used to lay in the grass on the hill and looking up at the clouds and try to see all the beings that were in there, the cows and cats or turtles, whatever it was. We used to use our imagination. We don't do that much anymore. So you're doing great. Forget the labyrinth necessarily because you're doing great walking in the woods. You're peace, you're quiet, you can be open to all the subtle sounds and whatever's out there, but the point is your mind is open to receive some information. It's not worrying about, you know, the Cowboys won in the last couple of minutes, you know, I'm happy about that. But we're not concerned about that. We're happy, we're open to receive information that's all around us, so you're doing a great job. You may entertain to walk a labyrinth or so to see if that does anything for you, but if it doesn't, not only are you doing it right, but if you're doing it regular or often, you're doing great. You're out there in nature, and you're open to receive.
Okay, go for it. Ask the question. Just go ahead and ask.
Okay. First of all, it's just awesome talk. Thank you. And then second, it's just more practical question. How long has the labyrinth at SMU been there?
I don't really know. I've been aware of it for 10 or 15 years.
Okay.
And somebody put some thought into that because that's not an idle thing. I mean, when they build these new buildings, see, here's a deep spiritual place, supposedly, and they're building it, and they had the walkway through. The other lady that I gave a talk to on this before, and she was talking about putting a labyrinth up in Frisco, but there was no follow-through. And the city had some place for it, and I don't want to push it on anybody because she was one of our walkers. And so when the Perkins did that, they probably thought about that, and because of the ancient religions and that, why don't we put a labyrinth here? But I can't look in the eye and say it was 63 and a half years ago or whatever, but I know 10 or 15 years has been there, so.
I got married at Perkins Chapel at SMU, and so I just know that there's some great energy there, but I did not know at the time of that labyrinth there, and I've got a long history with SMU, so I was just curious. That was
okay.
That's a beautiful
It
I'll
is.
Go look for it now.
Yeah, it's on the left side where the park is.
In the Meadows Museum, there's a lot of good energy.
Right,
there.
right. Yeah. So you're going to sing with me now? I'm going to the chapel and I'm going to get married?
Yeah, it happens. Yeah.
Okay.
As far as the chakras, the seven chakras, these have come up in the conversation about labyrinths. Do you wish to elaborate any on the chakras and maybe show any nexus with Christianity? I mean, a lot of these labyrinths are at churches. We've got seven churches, we've got seven candlesticks, we've got all this stuff in Revelation about the sevens.
And it comes from the frame of reference of the seven major chakras. We do have 12, and some people say we have more, but they're the energy points. I have a talk that I give called The Seven Genies Within, and there's special gifts that we have within our body temple that we never use because we're too busy. One is our junk DNA. One is our breathing, one is our sexuality, one is our meditating, one is our breathing. I have to think of the other one. So the chakras are also one of them. And their energy points are spirals of energy that we can use. And I always have people turn them on when we're doing meditation just to experience, and they never had before. And all of a sudden, it's an experience. But we have them within our body all the time. We just don't use them. We forget about them. I got to watch our time here. Tom is he's rubbing me on the neck or back and forth, the air conditioning on and off.
I just turned it, I got cold.
Yeah, that's fine. Anybody else?
Last question. Do we have a last question?
No, he's.
We're running out of questions.
Okay, all right. I guess we're to the rebuttal
phase
now. Oh, yeah, thank you. Yeah, yeah.
Right, well, you get to sit down now.
Yeah, I got to shut down my computer. Yeah, let me get this out of the way.
Now it's your turn to talk, so who wants to be first? There has to be a first. No one? I can't believe it. Someone, you get up here and say something?
You know me, I always say something.
All right.
Well, this is with regard to the subject of ley lines, and this is not a rebuttal as much as it's additional information. And can we please have it quiet on the set? To use video terms here. Quiet on the set. Thanks, folks. There is a particular breathing Raja Yoga meditation technique that they advise to never do while you're driving. And of course, I guess in my hubris and in my egotism, I figured, no problem. I mean, I know my consciousness. I mean, I know where I'm at. I'm not going to lose track of things going. But I was driving on a highway at approximately 60 miles an hour and happened to transit a ley line while I'm doing the breathing exercise. And in an instant, my vision popped up into a mode where I am seeing pictures from every single rod or cone in my eye, and I am seeing items in shops 4 miles away, and I'm seeing all this simultaneously. I'm seeing thousands of different pictures all at once. The one thing I can't see is the road ahead of me, and I'm coming up onto a bridge. That was a depends moment, and I was able to just tense my whole body and bring the vision back to a unitary vision, what we normally see. But ley lines can be dangerous if you're using yoga techniques you're not supposed to be using while you're driving.
Wow. Okay, who wants to be next? Have we got a next? Nobody has anything to say? You want to be next?
I'll refrain. I'll restrain myself.
That's it?
No.
We have a volunteer.
These ladies will let me out.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think you get through it, but watch yourself. Very, very narrow. Very, very narrow.
I know about ley lines.
Watch this now. Okay. Now you got it.
This is a maze.
Yes, now that is a maze, you're correct.
Amazing.
Okay, concerning ley lines, it is my understanding that all over the earth, they're in kind of like a spider web pattern. They cross in many, many, many different locations, and that the ancient cathedrals were built on the crossings of the ley lines, right up in the apse area of the church. And years ago, I took a girlfriend to Germany to go skiing with a group of people. And there was very little snow, so there was this other guy on the trip, and he said, well, why don't the three of us just get on the bus and go over to Vienna, Austria? And so we did, and we had lunch, and we went to a cathedral, and he talked about these ley lines. And then he started walking like this with his arms out along a path around the church, and then he got to a point and he said, right here. And I thought, oh, okay. And so then Denise decided, well, I've got to test this out. And she got over there in about the same area and she said, yes, I can feel it. And I thought, okay, I have to do this too. I got over in that area where they both had felt it, and it was like I had this muff of energy from the elbow all the way around like this that I could just... That one went out. okay, that I could just almost feel like not a, really a thing, but it just felt like it had mass to it. And it was very, very interesting. Then I walked on past that and it was gone, but just in that little area, which would be where it went through the cathedral. So I thought that was fascinating. Then there's one other thing. I think that we are so primitive in our development in science on this earth. We are just barely scratching the surface of knowledge. And I like the example that, well, I guess I'll go ahead and say this if I've got the time, that my physics 101 professor, who was the head of the department, he always liked to teach little starting kids like me in physics 101. And he, the first day he said, you know, physics is like a big barn that you walk into that's got a smooth floor, smooth walls, smooth ceiling, and it's huge. And it's got random little holes all over the ceiling through which ropes are hanging down. And they're at different levels. And he said that what we do in physics is we're trying to figure out what's up in the attic, and no one will ever have any way of getting up into that attic. So we first go and we measure the XY positions of all of these ropes because it's too high to go up to the roof to actually physically measure across to the hole. So we just measure as best we can at the ends of the ropes. And then we plot all that down and mark each one, give every rope a specific number so it has an ID, and then we measure the distance that that particular rope is from the floor. And then we'll go over to one rope and we'll pull it down a measured distance. And then we go measure all the other ropes and see if any of them went up or down. We'll mark all that down. And then we go pull another rope, or we pull the same one a different distance. And we make all of these recordings of the data that we find. And then somebody who's real smart in pulleys and pulley systems and the ratios will think and design in his mind this pulley system that would explain all of these phenomena. And then he will come out with his book, The Pulley System of the Universe, and he will sell his book and get on lecture tours and be well acclaimed and eventually get chairs in, you know, universities and so forth. And then there's this lady who comes along and she's an expert in gear systems, which are far more precise than pulleys. And she analyzes it all and she comes up with her system. And of course, there's slight deviations here and there in all of these systems, which we will not really pay much attention to because it's just probably the quality of the measuring systems that we have to date that we can just ignore that little bit of difference. So she comes up with her higher gear theory of the universe. And then some guy who is real good in hydraulics comes and designs his system. And he comes up with the universal hydraulic theory of the universe. And all these people are getting their books sold and their acclaim and they're getting fame and they're written up in magazines and they're interviewed and they get college chairs and so forth. But the fact is that no one has ever been in the attic. And that is the state of physics, and that's the way it always will be. We're making our best guess on the data that we have, but the barn is so big, the barn is so big, we will never be able to measure all the ropes, and you can pull any rope almost an infinite number of different distances. Now, with that in mind, this planet is just one tiny, tiny little planet compared to so many huge planets, but back in 62, Professor Hooper also taught astronomy, and I took Astronomy 101. And he taught us that, you know, this is 62. They didn't have the Hubble Space Telescope. They couldn't see a fraction of what they can see today. He said, you know, we estimate that there are 10 to the 17th power stars in our galaxy. Now, 10 to the 3 is a million, and a billion is 10 to the 6, and a trillion is 10 to the 9, and a quadrillion is 10 to the 12, and it goes up to 10 to the 17, you know, and I don't even know how to state the numbers. And that there are estimated 10 to the 17th power galaxies that they knew back then, which is 10 to the 34th power estimated number of stars. So if you take the Earth and make it a smooth sphere at sea level and take one grain of average size beach sand and put it on the Earth for each one of those stars, you would completely cover the Earth 2 feet thick in sand. Now, that's just a fraction of what they see today, a fraction of it. it's all infinite, and it'll be, physics will never end in its development. Now, Linda Howe used to be a journalist for a television station up in Colorado, and she was assigned to go out and do a story on cattle mutilations, which started happening some years ago, back probably in the 70s or so. And that just intrigued her totally, because there was technology used in these cattle mutilations that we didn't even have. The cuts were made between cells all the way through rather than slicing through cells. And I mean, we just couldn't do that. So this technology was not ours that was doing it. And nobody understood why, and we probably still don't know why they have done that, whoever they are. But she got off into that, and as a result, she got, for the rest of her life, she's been into the whole UFO alien area and studying everything that she can, and a lot of things on the earth and ancient civilizations and the relics they've left and so forth. Well, she showed some slides and talked about an event, and I forget a lot of the details, but there was this object that came into the earth from outer space, and it had no moving parts. And it had no apparent electronic circuitry on it or in it. But it was completely covered with this intricate, precise system of geometry. And the speculation was that the geometry itself contained all of the intelligence that gave this thing its mission and its power plant and its ability to fly from one planet to another, or one star system to another, to come to the Earth to perform a mission and to take that information and go back. Now, this is just beyond anything our science can even begin to accept or conceive of. But she showed photographs of that thing, and it did have intricate geometry carved in it. So I'm thinking that that's why I asked you the question about geometry. That we are just beginning to learn what geometry will do. What is that Japanese system about the way they arrange gardens and so forth?
Feng shui.
Feng shui? Yeah. They're learning about that as well, but it's still infantile. We're wearing a blinder in much of science, and we should not think that we have learned much in the area of science. It's fascinating.
Thank you. Okay, who's next? You gotta be a next. Come on up here.
Ah, I'll get my money's worth.
That was amazing. Too bad the atheist guy that was here last week isn't here. I want to hear him talk. So, I guess I'm an agnostic. That means I know I don't know. So now I'm more agnostic, and that is one more thing I don't know. I know I don't know. Anyway, I agree with what Albert says. I hope we're in our infancy or early adolescence in science, because otherwise we're not going to be here very long. We've only had science for a couple hundred years, and it's. As most things do, it accelerates for a while. And right now, we're in an interesting period. So I'm going to kind of go on for a tangent. I don't know much about labyrinths. It's just something more for me to learn about. So I'm going to kind of tie it back to the atheism and scientism. I mentioned that word last time. Science versus scientism. I'm going to kind of go off on a digression, if you don't mind. Scientism is a term that's derogatory. It's for people who worship science or kowtow to it in the wrong way. The part of science I respect is based on the scientific method, which has given us all our wonderful advances and labor saving and technology and more science. Like every time you learn something, you get more questions. Scientism is when that doesn't hold priority anymore. Oh, God. Mark, cover your eyes even more. Cover your ears. I really started thinking about this even more when 911 was something I looked into. Yeah, absolutely. The and then global warming. So the experts say a certain thing, that we're heating up and it's because of the oil companies and blah, 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 blah. And all the predictions have been wrong. That doesn't matter. 911, there was Building 7. Just one, but there's a whole bunch of, there's actually something called scientists for 911 truth. There's firefighters for 911 truth. There's architects and engineers for 911 truth. There's over 2,000 architects and engineers that signed their name. Believe me, there's 10 behind that were scared to sign their name that said, yes, this is bogus. So anyway, what happened? What happened was, like in Galileo's day, they said, the majority of scientists say that it could have happened. The towers fell like this, or the polar bears are swimming. What it is now, when it's cold, it's because of global warming. It is. That's what they say. Who says that? The warmest. The people who are died in the war. I have plenty of friends like that. There's millions of people. It's called climate change. They changed the name. So, like, you know, if I'm giving you, selling you a chocolate bar and it's a piece of, you know, a bottle of sauerkraut. Oh, it's a white chocolate. You know, it's like, come on. Anyway, so what it is, one of the basic logical fallacies, all logic, talking about Greece is where it started. Greeks came up with the logical fallacies to help us debate in a civilized manner and advance our knowledge together. One of the basic logical fallacies is appeal to authority. That's a basic, when you're debating somebody, if you say, well, like the Bible says, and then, you know, because it's in the Bible, and it just goes around in a circle, that's what happens when you appeal to authority. You have to connect to something observable and so forth. So now the scientists are the new priests, and it's something you got to watch out for. So I see I'm aggravating people, but that's my job. Thank you.
Okay, who's next? There's got to be a next. Come on up here, John.
Well, speaking as one of the new priests of science, well, there you go. It's
is it on?
Yeah, it's
right.
I just left.
Okay. Anyway. Okay. Speaking as one of the new priests of science, actually, John asked me to say something about ley lines. Well, ley lines are very common in the British Isles, but really, it comes from magnetic fields. As you know, birds have a mechanism that detects magnetic field of the Earth. In fact, as you know, these fields go north to south, and of course they're influenced by magnetic properties inside the Earth. So occasionally they concentrate, and this is what birds and in fact some people can sense. So it's not fantasy. And so the ancients, of course, in Britain, didn't have maps, they didn't have Google. And so they followed these magnetic concentrations, and you can see it because they would erect large stones and they would be able to navigate from village to village. And so very often, the reason why some churches have these big steeples is you can actually see this along these ley lines. You can actually see this big stone lining up with a steeple and lining up with another steeple. And oftentimes, it will line up with you know, intersections of mountain ranges and so on. So really, it was used really as a way of navigation before you had compasses and everything else. Because you know, people had to get their goods from one village to another, and so that's really the use and the origin of ley lines. So they're really there's nothing magical about it. They were used, and you can actually see them, and they intersect and, and cross. In fact, a lot of the main Roman roads, like the Fosse Way that the Romans built in England, follow these ley lines. So they really, there's nothing magical, as I say. They're quite common. Now, as for science and stuff like that, the really thing to say about science is there is no absolutes in science. In fact, you just go with the best evidence, and people fall in love with their theories, but eventually, if the theory is wrong, they'll have to put up their hands and say, "Sorry, I was wrong," and I'll dream up a new theory. But the thing is that for a time, it's rather like Newton's law of gravity. I mean, it stood the test for many hundreds of years until Einstein came along and said, "Well, you know, there is a more general law, and Newton's is just a particular case of it." And so, but science operates like that. It's self-correcting. And I only wish that some of these religions were self-correcting, but one of the big problems is they're not.
Okay, who's next? We got a next? Ran out of next. Am I the last one standing?
I guess. A little more about bird navigation.
Bird navigation. Come on up here.
No, well, I just have a question. I would like for our speaker to tell us a little bit more about the.
This is not getting on tape, by the way.
No, no.
Where's the mic?
Yeah. Okay. Where's the mic? Oh, wait a minute.
Are they predictable grid lines like parallels and latitude, longitude?
Yes.
They are. So we can predict where they may be. If we know where this one is, we can measure off certain latitude, longitude, and come up with the.
There's.
Let's see, here was on the camera.
They're like a screen door screen. No, they have that pattern as far
right.
as they make.
Right.
Look up on Google, look up on grid lines on the planet and see what you come up with. And I'll show you. They're very definite and they're there.
Well, if I wanted to find one here, how would I go about doing that locally?
You might get. Are you in the thousand?
You want to answer her at the microphone?
Yeah,
come on up here and answer.
I was getting used to sitting down there for a while.
Yeah, I know.
For me.
Are you into dowsing at all?
Not a whole lot. No.
I'm into dozing right now, but
dowsing maybe.
I have a lot of intuitive friends. The church that I go into, Unity, some ladies will come in and they'll immediately feel what's going on in there because of the energy. Now, Deepak Chopra in his book, The Book of Secrets, he said that we have possible little hairs on our intestine. And he suggests, could they be antennae? And if they're antennae, could we men, and the ladies too, have a gut feeling? Mm-hmm. So the first time you see somebody, the first time you have that gut feeling, if it's good or bad. Now you ladies, the word on the street is you also have an intuitiveness.
Right.
We have it too, but we're not told about it. So you know your husband or boyfriend or whatever the situation is, when they're talking to you, and depending on how they look at you, you can feel if they're telling you the truth or not. And so we guys can do this. So people that are dowsers or people that are intuitive, just like the example was back here when they were over in Vienna, they walked over the place and they felt it. So I have a lady friend in Fort Worth. She called me up out of the blue because she's being invited to the What's the lodges people have down in Dallas and the?
Which are you talking about, the Rosicrucians? Or
no, the other crazy people that, the Shriners and the who else?
Masonic,
the Masons.
Yeah.
Masonic
lodges.
So the Masonic lodges usually have, they're on ley lines, and so she's being invited this coming week.
Oh.
And also, if you're into the woo-woo stuff, we have the four blood moons coming up. We have the Pope coming over. He's going to talk to the President. They're going to take Agenda 21 in the United Nations, put up to Agenda 30. We're ready to have a crash anytime, you know, whatever you want to talk about. So she's over at the Masonic Lodge in Fort Worth, which is probably also on the ley line, and she's being invited to sing. And so I'm stimulating her, why not when you're in there, look for all the symbology, feel the feelings that are in the Masonic Lodge there, and besides doing the minuet or whatever she's going to do, why don't you get the little Druid song and get down tonight because she's going to be talking to little kids. And so why don't you just feel that energy over there in a Masonic lodge and look for the symbology, and you can report back to me later. So people that do dowsing can help you. Ladies or guys that are intuitive can help you. And you can also challenge yourself. I don't know where you live, but the Masonic lodges usually are on those different ley lines, and just sense, or you might have some other people that are intuitive. I don't know whether that helps you. Do you know what dowsing is?
No.
David Wilcox's program, he mentions a machine that you can use to find certain areas that are actually unhealthy to live over.
Yes. Yes. If you,
can you repeat the question?
The question was about how do you find ley lines in the area?
What is dowsing?
What's that?
What is dowsing?
Well, that's a backup question.
Okay, dowsing. I have some friends up in Hot Springs Village who live on the edge of it, and they have a 10 square acre piece of land. And I'm saying to myself, this is an ego problem. What?
I got to look at you? Tell it to her. I know what it is. Tell it to her.
Okay.
She
okay. So these people had 10 acres, and I used to teach, when I come out of the teaching closet, because I was very tough on myself, I did the Celestine Prophecy, and my gift is storytelling. And so I took that thing that the lady was struggling with, and there's 9 insights, and I did a 10-week course. And I asked questions, and we go around the circle and find out, and then I do a guided imagery for each one. And so one of the people in the class moved up to Hot Springs Village, and they talked about these people. They had 10 acres, and one of the guys was actually a rocket scientist from Houston. So they had these 3 people up in these 10 acres of land, and it was trashed. And it was back in the forest up there right off Hot Springs Village, because they have a lot of trees, and they made a magnificent property. They had all these pyramids, these copper pyramids, and they had a wagon wheel out front like the Indians do. And the guy had these little dowsing things. They were like this, but they were the L shape. And they do this in oil fields sometimes too. So before we walked his labyrinth that had 7 colors of the chakra on there, he would do a reading on us, and he would see where these things were at. Then we walked the labyrinth, and we came out, and he did this again with these dowsers, and they would swing way out. So we'd have to walk all the way on the other side of the labyrinth so they could actually get our energy, because they could feel it. So dowsing.
Didn't they use that to find water?
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
And there's a guy. There's an old.
And oil.
Oil. Yes. There's and a guy. There's a guy that's a healer, and he uses dowsing rods. And I'm trying to remember his name. He's an old country healer, and he has a bobber, which is a dowsing thing, and it'll be there, and he'll heal people. We're going to be out in two hours.
Hours is too long. I like you. You're a fun guy.
What's that?
I said I like you. You're a fun guy.
Yeah, I know. I'm not too loud.
You're still all right.
So, I think his name was Russell something. He used to take his bobber, and they used to tell him, "I got a problem," and he'd use his dowsing type thing. It was a spring. I have one myself, and he would send healing energy to these people because he believed he could do it, and he healed people with it. So a dowsing thing is a rod. It's an L-shaped thing. And you can, some people do this or whatever. It's like, you know what a pendulum is? So it's another, pendulum is another type of thing. So where do you live at? Ballpark.
Mesquite.
Okay. Maybe check for the Masters of Mesquite or something. So the question is, as you get into this stuff, you can see, you're on a path now. So see who's intuitive. Sometimes you have a lady over there, she's got a big triangle in her house, and she does readings. She's down in your neck of the woods. And so she has an intuitiveness, and so she can look at you and read cards or whatever. All that stuff is games. Most people are any good. They can look at you. They can sense your body language. They can, it's all kinds of things. But I send all these emails out, and I always tell my people, you read, you decide, because you may not agree with this email, with this information. So you can get somebody's intuitive, you can use dowsing rods, or you can have other people that are just, they know.
Well, if we have a set point somewhere in the Metroplex here, then we could...
On the microphone, please.
If we have a known point of reference somewhere here in the Metroplex, could we just measure the distance north, south, east, and west from that point to kind of get in the ballpark of where to find that ley line?
I have a couple different answers to that. The problem is we have a seven major chakra system in our body temple, but we have other chakras. Some people even say 33, and we have some that go up high above us. So we can really tune into the main seven, but sometimes the other one that are there, they're lighter energy than these main ones. So it's finding that main one, and then it's kind of being intuitive. You go north, south, east, or west, and see you might feel lighter energy patterns. But then once you have a compass or you have a knowingness with inside, I don't want to get off the deep end, but you know, I had one of my projects was all these cell towers, and so I was behind a lot of this stuff, and we had energy things to change the frequency and all that, and it was with copper and crystals and all kinds of strange stuff. And so we did that in the old days because we had meters. We had meters, and we could feel the energy off those cell towers, and it was like a radiation meter, blah, 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 blah. So I sneak out in the middle of the night and do my routine.
So the ley lines are basically magnetic fields?
Magnetic or energetic fields. I mean, they're definitely magnetic, but they're also energetic.
They're probably harmonic.
There's probably a tool that measures magnetic energy, right? A tool that you could buy?
Well, so here's the bad news. Fukushima basically had a problem, you know, and the government's not admitting to anything, and because of that, they're getting radiation off that thing. And so now we have two problems. We have a pile of trash coming over past Hawaii. It's going to get our west coast. And people in California are using Geiger counters to measure the radiation, and they're starting to feel and see it on a Geiger counter. So that's coming over, and everybody's lying about it. And one guy, when they panicked when they had that Fukushima thing, which was my feeling, we're talking conspiracy, there was nukes. They put nukes into the ground over there to create a big wave to knock out Tokyo, because Tokyo wasn't going in with what the powers of being, the Bilderbergers and all those crazy people were talking about. So most people don't want to hear that. I don't want to get into that because that's not my talk tonight. So they did that, and one guy was saying Tokyo is destroyed. And because they have all this radiation over there, and we're starting to gather it. And how you measure that is with simple Geiger counters. Now, I'd like to look you in the eye and say you get into auras. Auras is your energy field around you in the color. You saw when I had that staff I had, the lady took a picture of me with her iPhone. And you can see the different colors. Is that good or bad, right or wrong? There's people that can see that, the people that can feel that, the people that know that. And so whether they have a ley line machine, I don't know, but I know the people that are intuitive and are dowsers and are pendulum people can find it real quick.
We have time for a last question.
She's giving me the elbow. I don't know what that means.
Just one quick question. This is going right into what you're saying, but speaking of powers that be, like controlling information, have there been efforts that you're aware of within our government and to suppress this? This is ancient knowledge. I know the labyrinth, nobody really knows where the first one was. And obviously, like you say, the sites of these temples, and whether you call it magnetic, radiation, what was the other one, energetic. You know, to me, it's just like you're saying different words for the same thing.
Right.
And you said Hancock didn't speak right, about right. this right. Sort of thing anymore, the ancient cities. And I wonder if he's ever been suppressed or oppressed.
Well, he is. He's been shut off of TED because he gave that talk talking about consciousness. And the powers of be don't want you to know you have imagination, you have consciousness.
Unconsciousness, the great collective unconscious that
yes.
Carl Jung spoke of as
yes.
well. And, yeah. And I'm wondering if that you're accessing some of that when you're walking these. Okay.
We got to wrap it up.
What do you want to do?
You need to sit down.
2 minutes.
Yeah, thank you.
Do you want to wrap in 2 minutes, John?
Well, he wants to talk
here. Well, anyway, so I'm going to let our speaker finish this up. So he's got the last word.
Real quick, the whole purpose of this meeting tonight was that we have consciousness. There's a war on consciousness by the powers of be. They don't want to realize we're manifesting and creating gods. They don't want us to do that. So they want to dumb us down, they want to fluoride us, they want to do all this crap. I had an annual physical, and the doctor's a nice guy, but he wanted to give me four poisons. I didn't want that, and I'm not going to do that. And so the idea is you're manifesting, creating God, and all you have to do, I like your idea of walking in the woods over there. That's the simplicity of being out in nature. That's great. So I'm inviting you to take a look at developing your consciousness, meditate or whatever you need to do. Yes, we have information overload, but what are you doing to empower yourself to embrace the God you really are? That's the purpose of this whole thing tonight. Consciousness, labyrinth is one way to do it. Very simple, outside, down and dirty and quick. So that's all I have. Thank you.